Thanks, Rod. Questions at the end, as usual. And now I have the pleasure to introduce somebody you already know, Cristiano Irala from Aspetar. Some things that you don't know about Cristiano is that before joining in Aspetar in 2007 as one of the first doctors of Aspetar, he was actually an accomplished football player and stopped his football career to join Aspetar to build up sports medicine here. And he's also done a lot of research on injuries in football, has pioneered the work on injuries in the GCC football athletes. So, Cristiano, we're curious to hear about this topic from you, please.
Thank you, Olaf. Saidati sanati, assalamu alaikum, wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. I know that, that you get the clap. Yosharofoni. Anakon maakon hona wa ashkurukum ala adurakum wa ashkur aspetar ala di al forsa wa alam saufa ata adat bilenglisia wa elalan nasol ala algada aliom. Said that, we can start with the presentation. I know everybody was listening to me. Said that I have no disclosure, and so injury epidemiology in the GCC, as we said from the first session that was about injury history, about history of GCC sport medicine, I think history is very important. It will allow us to avoid mistakes in the present and will show us the way of the future. So first of all, I had a look to a textbook of epidemiology in medicine. And I have tried to see which was the position of the Arabic medicine. And I have found, for example, in this book, that the first epidemiologist is considered Hippocrates. And the same textbook is said that then, for about 2,000 years, no major advancement have been done until the 17th century, when John Ground started his work. In reality, history is important, but it's also important to know languages, as you know, at least two. And so I'm Italian, and I went to Italian literature and said, we are so bright, why nobody did anything for 2,000 years in epidemiology, in medicine? And I found that, for example, the unknown physician Girolamo Fracastoro did during the 15th century in Verona some good research on epidemiology in medicine, but is not mentioned by an English book. And so I said, I'm not talking Arabic, so I cannot go and see the Arabic literature, but I found in the Journal of the International Society for the History of Islamic Medicine, I found that there was a physician, Al-Razi, that contributed a lot in the 9th century to different branches of epidemiology. And he was born in Persia.
And he's changed life.
Okay. He spent big part of his life in Iraq. And he was not only a physician, but like all the scientists of this time, he was also a polymath, an alchemist, a philosopher. So this is just to say that Arabic medicine gave a contribution also to epidemiology, like in other fields. What about sport injury epidemiology in the GCC? First of all, I have to find a picture for this slide. And when I Googled it, it came out that Qatar won the last edition of Gulf Cup. And sorry, I had to celebrate that. Sorry for our guest. It was after 12 years of waiting. And in Europe, the cornerstone of injury epidemiology is the PhD thesis of Jan Ekstrand. And his paper were published in 82, 83. So I was asking myself what it was happening in the GCC during this period. And in reality, I'm not sure if it's the first one, but what I was able to find is that in Saudi Arabia in 85, this paper on sport injury was published. And it was a paper analyzing the injury for 12 consecutive months in King Fahd Hospital. Sport injury, mainly football, as you can see, and but also other sport, especially tennis, jogging, basketball, and so on, were collected prospectively. And as you can see, the main injury were located, most of the injuries were located to the knee, ankle, and shoulder, so the articulation. But this is not surprise. It's not a surprise if we think that all these injuries went to an hospital. In fact, we have a high percentage of bony and ligamentous injury that together are the biggest part of the injury that arrived at the attention of the authors. And which population was involved? Especially the young people, the young athletes, so 11, 20, and 21, 30 years. And in this paper, there is a classification of the different population that we have to deal with normally in sport medicine. I think it was very interesting. We have the first group, so under 15 years, are these athletes, young, and that they, if they don't have a proper guidance, they may suffer for repetitive injuries. Then we have the second group, 16 to 30 years. These athletes that are at competitive level, professional or not, and that they incur injury that sometimes can be also severe. Then we have the third group, 30, 40 years. So still trying to be competitive, but in reality, it is more for keeping themselves fit. So what we call in Europe, the Sunday warriors. And then we have the fourth group, the over 40. The people that are even not anymore competitive, but are trying to keep themselves fit, participating in sport. In reality, if we think about it, it's really the main group we have to deal in our activity. But what was even more interesting from this paper, it was the conclusion. And so you can see that in the conclusion, they said that the author said that especially the under 15 require proper guidance in and education in various sport activities. Their education should include, for example, how to avoid injuries and how to roll rather than take a hard knock when falling down. And this is exactly the concept of prevention. So while Ekstrand was doing his work, the same concept was present here. Then they also said that there was a need for a center where the physician understand the nature of their injury and treat them without delay and rehabilitate them quickly to enable them to return to their games early. And this is a sort of vision. So it's a call for a specialized sport medicine center and for a specialized class of physician. 25 years later, a paper on epidemiology of injury was published in Kuwait, and it was concerning four ball games: football, basketball, handball, and volleyball. And it was a cross-sectional study, so based on a questionnaire. And it has been found that there was a high prevalence of sport injury in athletes. So you can see that overall 12 months, 73.8% of the athletes were injured, so 3 over 4 incur in an injury during the year, during one season, and 90% of them during their entire career. So again, the conclusion was that we have to do something. We need to create something to support this athlete. And again, there was a call for prevention, for something that may reduce the incidence of injury, not only the treatment. So things have not changed much in two different countries and two different periods. And I think that Aspetar, when it was decided here to create Aspetar, was the best way to respond to this call. And so this is exactly the vision that was advocated since the case. And what about prevention? So we created, Qatari people created Aspetar, and then which intervention were done or have to be done in order to reduce the incidence of injuries in sport. I think that the highest level of prevention is when you are able to present so strong data that you are obliging the governing body to change the rules of the game. Like, for example, it happened in football. When FIFA changed the rule of the game in 98, for example, punishing the tackle from behind with a red card on the basis of epidemiological data. It happened also later, punishing with a red card also the elbow. So this is really a big step. And but I think that from the Gulf is coming even a higher example. For many years, this is a paper from Qatar, from Hamad Hospital. For many years, were collected data about the injury in camel jockey, especially in children. And it has been shown that they were incurring many injuries during the race, and some of them severe or debilitating. And the same was happening in the Emirates. In the Emirates, they were showing approximately the same data. Again, this is a paper from a university teaching hospital. And both countries in 2005 implemented a law in order to forbid the camel racing for the under 18. And we can see from this paper how when the law was implemented, the injury among children passed from 13 to 0. So the authors conclude that this is possibly one of the few examples where child injury has been completely prevented by legislation. And again, it's not the normal legislation of the game, but it's the legislation of a whole country. So I think that one of the biggest examples of injury prevention is coming really from the Gulf. Sorry. So I would like to close this talk with the beginning of the discussion of the first paper by Sadat Ali and Sankaran Kuti that on sport injury in Saudi Arabia. They start their discussion saying that the Prophet Muhammad in his wisdom advised his followers to take up archery, swimming and horse riding as sport. So there is no need, but this underline and highlight even more the importance of sport. And so this is highlighting how our role of the people today is vital. If for years our class could have been discussed because taking care of only sport injury was not enough serious, I think things are changing very quickly. Thank you very much.